When a young woman finally seeks help for the heavy headache she's been experiencing for weeks, a nurse takes a closer look and immediately runs away. For weeks, Carla had been battling an unrelenting headache. She could feel the heavy weight of it pressing down on her skull, and she was starting to worry about how long she'd been experiencing the pain. It was affecting her whole life. She was short-tempered with her two children and could barely concentrate at work. As a single mother, she had to do her best at her job. She couldn't afford to lose it, and she hated being so snappy with the kids, but all she wanted to do was crawl into bed and try and sleep away the pain. Something definitely wasn't right. And when the dizziness set in, almost knocking her to the floor one morning, she knew it was time to get help. She'd been brushing the pain off as stress due to the pressures of raising two young children and building a career, too. It was hardly surprising that she'd been suffering from headaches, given the sleepless nights and the long days. The pain was a dull throb at first, but recently it had worsened. It was unlike any headache or migraine that she'd experienced before, but it wasn't going away, and that scared her. The spots that danced at the edges of her vision and the unrelenting pain were too much to bear. What if this was something serious? She knew all sorts of horrible things could start with a headache, and now she regretted trying to ignore it for so long. She made an appointment at the clinic, and when she explained her symptoms, they told her to come straight down. At the local clinic, the nurse on duty, Megan, had been kind but efficient as she listened to Carla's complaint of a heavy headache. She nodded sympathetically and took down notes, then checked Carla's blood pressure and reflexes. The results showed nothing indicating why the young woman was suffering so much. The usual culprits, stress, dehydration, lack of sleep, were all considered, and while it couldn't be denied that Carla had a little bit of pressure in her life, it wasn't anything out of the ordinary, and she was otherwise fit and well. In short, there was no immediate explanation for why she'd been suffering from a headache for so long, but as Carla described her increasingly blurry vision and the nauseating pressure inside her skull, Megan frowned. "Something's not right," Megan thought to herself, her gut instincts tingling. This wasn't just stress or dehydration, and it wasn't the usual headache complaint she often heard from busy mothers or workaholics. There was something different about this case. The symptoms were too persistent and severe, and Carla's face was pale, her skin almost sickly with a slight yellow hue. Despite the routine questions and standard tests, the nurse could feel there was something more that needed investigating. However, she could tell that the young woman was already scared, and she didn't want to worry her any further by letting on how concerned she was. The nurse explained to Carla that she wanted to do a few more checks. Megan asked Carla to tilt her head forward as she prepared to examine her eyes. The moment Carla lowered her head, a strange sensation washed over her. A sudden, intense wave of nausea hit, and a loud pop rang in her ears. Her vision blurred momentarily before her focus snapped back. The nurse grabbed a cardboard vomit bowl and handed it to the young woman while she held her steady on the chair. The moment passed, and Carla apologized, but the nurse brushed it off. It wasn't anything she hadn't dealt with before, but seeing the worsening of the woman's symptoms just confirmed to her that this wasn't a simple headache. Megan leaned in close to inspect her pupils, and something caught her eye. Something that made her pause. A slight movement. At first, Megan thought it was just the result of eye strain. But no, there it was again, an almost undetectable twitch in the skin just above Carla's temple, like the skin itself was moving. Megan's heart skipped a beat. Could it be a muscle spasm? She leaned in closer, trying to get a better look. The flickering movement was subtle, but it was undeniably there, like something alive beneath Carla's skin. Now it was Megan's turn to feel the nausea wash over her. This was so far from anything she'd dealt with before, and she felt out of her depth. Megan stepped back, her hands trembling slightly as she glanced at Carla, who was oblivious, her eyes half closed in exhaustion. It was obvious that she hadn't felt the movement at all. Had she been living with this all these weeks and not even known? The nurse's mind raced with possibilities: an insect bite, a parasitic infection, something abnormal. But nothing could prepare her for what happened next. Just as Megan was about to reassure Carla to keep her calm and suggest a scan, the flicker under her skin suddenly intensified. A distinct bulge appeared, stretching the skin on Carla's temple. It wasn't huge, but it was unmistakable this time. There was no explaining this away, no brushing it off as a mistake. A small mound pushed outward, pulsating slowly. Megan gasped in horror. The shape shifted, then retracted slightly as if whatever was beneath the skin had decided to retreat. Megan's heart was pounding now, her mind reeling. If it was what she thought it was, she was about to get sick. She'd never seen anything like it before. Being a nurse, she tried to remain logical, but she couldn't help thinking about those body invasion horror movies her husband liked. She knew it was silly, but it was almost like some kind of alien-like creature had nestled in Carla's brain. This whole situation felt disturbingly wrong, and it made her skin crawl. Without thinking, she took a step back, then another, until she was halfway across the room before she even realized that she'd been backing away from the woman that she was supposed to be taking care of. Her mouth was dry and her hands clammy. She wanted nothing more than to be out of that room, away from Carla, and far from whatever was happening. The bulge slightly shifted again, and this time, it seemed to contract faster and faster on Carla's forehead. Megan's breath caught in her throat, and the rational part of her brain screamed for her to stay calm, but she couldn't. It was too much. It was too disgusting and too unnatural. Her stomach churned. Without another word, she spun on her heel and bolted from the room, barely keeping the contents of her stomach down as she ran. Carla, confused and alarmed, watched the nurse flee in terror. The sight of Megan, wide-eyed and bolting from the room, made her own fear spike. Something was wrong, and she didn't know what it was. She jumped off the examination bed in an attempt to follow the nurse, but the intense pain that followed her sudden movement sent her crumbling to the floor. She held onto a chair leg to try and stop herself from shaking as the hot tears flowed from her eyes. What was happening to her? She'd come to the clinic for help and answers, and now the nurse had run away. There was no hiding from the fact that something terrible was going on. She'd seen the way the nurse had backed away from her, but she just wanted to know what she'd seen that had caused her so much fear. She couldn't even stand up to try and find Megan, though. In the hallway, Megan was trembling, her back pressed against the wall as she tried to catch her breath. Her mind raced through possibilities, but all she could think about was the unnatural movement beneath Carla's skin, the pulsating bulge. Her mind went to the worst-case scenarios. What if it was something deadly, something infectious? She'd just been in the room with her, thinking that she was dealing with a simple headache or migraine. She'd never seen anything like it, certainly not in real life. It was like something was living inside Carla's head. She knew it had been highly unprofessional to run away, but she'd been so horrified that her instincts had kicked in and told her she needed to get as far away as possible. The problem was, Carla was unaware that something was going on in her head, and now she'd been left all alone in the examination room. Megan needed to do something but couldn't return to that room. Frantically, Megan called for the attending doctor, trying to collect herself as she explained what she had seen. At first, she could detect the disbelief on his face. He thought she was making this all up. But the more she told him about Carla's symptoms and what she'd seen, the disbelief was replaced with concern. Within minutes, a full team was in Carla's room and she was rushed into an emergency CT scan. The doctor spoke in hushed tones, the tension in the air thick enough to cut with a knife. No one had told the young woman why the nurse had run away despite her asking over and over again. They kept conversation with the young woman to a minimum, simply telling her she needed a scan right away. As the images from the scan began to appear, everyone stared at the monitor in shock. The scan revealed what no one had expected. Deep within Carla's brain, nestled near the temporal lobe, was a cluster of cyst-like sacs. At first glance, the doctors suspected a parasitic infection, possibly caused by a rare tapeworm or some other invasive organism. The sacs were filled with fluid, and there in the heart of the mass were unmistakable living larvae. The doctors were horrified. It was a condition they had only ever seen in medical textbooks or the rarest cases from underdeveloped countries, neurocysticercosis. The condition was very rarely seen in developed countries, and none of them had experience dealing with it. Somehow, a tapeworm's larvae had infiltrated Carla's system and made their way to her brain, likely from something she had consumed months or even years ago. The weight Carla had felt pressing down on her skull was caused by the growing larvae sacs, inflamed tissue, and fluid buildup that had been compressing her brain. Megan had been right. Something was living inside Carla's head, and it needed to be removed. Although they were medical professionals who had seen all manner of things in their careers, the thought of something burrowing into the human brain was enough to churn even the most experienced stomachs. They found themselves subconsciously running their hands through their hair or scratching their heads. The images in front of them made them feel strange and uncomfortable. The attending doctor had been furious at Megan for running away from a patient and acting so unprofessional, but now he could understand why she had. Despite their lack of experience, they needed to come up with a treatment plan for Carla, a way to remove what was living in her head as soon as possible. The worst thing was, someone still needed to break the news to the young woman too. Sitting Carla down, they explained the situation to her. She was still groggy from the sedatives they had given her to calm her down. When they'd initially rushed to the examination room where Megan had left her, they'd found the young woman on the floor, hysterically crying and cradling her head in her hands. There'd been no safe way to take her for a CT scan without sedation. Now she could feel the drugs wearing off, but what the doctors were saying didn't seem to make sense. She felt numb, the gravity of her condition only partially sinking in. larvae in her brain? She couldn't wrap her mind around it. The headaches, the blurred vision, the strange pressure, all of it had been leading to this. The very idea was nauseating, more so than the headaches themselves had ever been. The horrified face Megan had pulled flashed into her mind, and it suddenly clicked that the nurse must have seen something moving. As the doctors explained she would need surgery to remove the larvae sacs, Carla mindlessly nodded in agreement. Instinctively, she reached for her hair as the doctors carried on talking, seemingly unaware of the distress that was building up in the young woman, and she began to pull. The shock of the news and the effect of the sedative combined to make her act out of character. "Get it out!" Carla screamed, thinking about something buried deep in her brain as she grabbed fistfuls of her hair. While the doctors could understand the extreme reaction to the news, this wasn't helping anyone. One of them hit the panic button, and a few seconds later, a nurse appeared with another syringe of sedative. The best thing for everyone right now was to keep Carla calm while they prepped her for surgery. Almost as soon as the syringe had pierced her skin, the woman's hands fell away from her hair, and the team that had been supporting her felt her muscles relax as they transferred her to a bed. The doctors immediately scheduled surgery to remove the sacs. The procedure would be delicate, given the larvae's proximity to critical areas of the brain, but it had to be done. The team prepared for what they knew would be one of the most stomach-turning operations of their careers, and likely one that they would never do again. It would be a long and slow procedure to ensure that every trace of the tapeworm and its larvae were removed from her brain without causing any complications. The surgery took several hours. When they opened Carla's skull, the sight that greeted them was every bit as grotesque as they had feared. The sacs were swollen, pulsating slightly with the life inside them. Each one had to be meticulously removed, taking care not to rupture them and release their contents into Carla's brain. The surgeons worked in tense silence, the occasional muttered instruction breaking the stillness of the room. One by one, they extracted the sacs, careful not to look too closely at the writhing larvae inside. It was a scene out of a horror movie, but this was no fictional situation. It was all too real. They couldn't think about the fact that they were extracting tapeworms from the woman's head too closely. They just had to detach themselves from the situation and get the job done. The final sac, larger than the rest, clung stubbornly to the surrounding tissue. With a slow, steady hand, the lead surgeon severed it from its hold, dropping it into the sterile container with a soft thud. The surgery was over, and there wasn't one person in the operating room that couldn't wait to get out of there. This was a day that none of them would ever forget. It felt like a nightmare that they'd all lived through. Carla's ordeal wasn't over yet, though. She was stitched back together and placed in recovery. The doctors began the next stage of her treatment. It would be a long journey until she was fully healed. Not only did she now have a large surgical scar on her skull, but she would need medication to kill any remaining parasites in her system. The thought of what had been living inside her, growing in her brain, haunted her dreams for weeks after. She couldn't sleep because every time she closed her eyes, she imagined the tapeworms living in her brain, the pulsating sacs throbbing like a heartbeat. She stopped eating because the nausea from the thought of what had been inside her was too much to handle, and she was terrified of reinfecting herself. But as her headaches subsided and her vision slowly cleared, a sense of relief washed over her. The pressure that had plagued her for so long was finally gone, but she would need a bit more help to deal with the trauma of what she had experienced. Eventually, Carla returned to her life, her children, and her job, though nothing would ever be quite the same again. She'd been given the all clear. There was no more tapeworm infection, and the surgical site had healed well, but the mental scar stayed with her. The experience had changed her, made her more cautious, more aware of the unseen dangers in the world around her. She started therapy knowing that she couldn't live the rest of her life in fear with minimal food and sleep. In time, she came to accept how rare what had happened to her was, and her life began to slowly return to some sense of normality. Alongside the fear, though, Carla was grateful that the nurse had looked closer, grateful for the doctors who had acted swiftly despite never dealing with anything like that before, and grateful for her life, which had come perilously close to being snatched away by something so horrifyingly small. Megan, the nurse who had run away in terror, couldn't shake the memory of that first sight, the bulge, the movement, the pulsating muscle. But as Carla recovered, she went to visit her and apologized for her behavior. Thankfully, the young woman brushed it off and told Megan not to worry about it. Megan had been right to trust her instincts, even if they had made her run away in fear. Ultimately, she had saved the young woman's life by believing that something wasn't right, and that Carla wasn't just experiencing a heavy headache. The whole thing had affected the nurse, too, though, and not long after Carla left the hospital looking much healthier than when she'd first arrived, Megan took some time off to process everything. Time was the only thing that would heal Megan and Carla, but eventually the story of tapeworm larvae in the young woman's brain would fade. the images wouldn't be so terrifying and haunting, and they'd both get on with their lives. Now it's over to you. What do you think of this story? Do you know any other stories where people have mistaken a headache for something much worse? We'd love to hear your thoughts, so please leave a comment below. Thanks for watching. We'll see you in the next video.